Scaling out and scaling in, made simple with AKS Automatic. My name is Paul Yu, and I am a cloud-native developer advocate at Microsoft. And in this episode, we'll take a deeper look at all the scaling capabilities that AKS Automatic enables for you out of the box. So let's go. Now, when it comes to scaling, there are two types of scaling that you need to be aware of. First is pod autoscaling, where we increase the number of pod replicas based on demand. Then there's cluster autoscaling, where we need to increase the number of nodes to run more replicas. We can tell Kubernetes to run lots of replicas, but if there aren't enough compute resources, it'll never be scheduled and the pod will be stuck in pending state. And so AKS Automatic solves these two scaling concerns by leveraging open source projects, KEDA and Karpenter. For pod autoscaling, KEDA, or the Kubernetes Event Driven Autoscaler, is installed as an AKS add-on. KEDA is an operator that runs in your cluster and is used in conjunction with HPA, or the Horizontal Pod Autoscaler. It basically tells HPA to increase or decrease pod replica counts based on whatever scaler you deploy. And there's many different types of scalers that KEDA supports, so it can scale based on pretty much anything that emits a metric. It could be CPU and memory based on events, or even messages in a queue. The list goes on and on. For cluster autoscaling, AKS Automatic enables a feature called Node Auto Provision, which is based on the Karpenter project developed and donated to the CNCF by friends at AWS. The AKS engineering team contributed a provider for the Karpenter project that enables usage with Azure. And this node autoscaler ensures that you're running the right nodes at the right time. And the best part of Node Auto Provision is that it not only helps you scale your cluster out when demand requires it, but it also helps you run more optimally by bin packing workloads to run on the most cost-effective virtual machine SKUs in Azure. So it'll eventually save you money in the long run. And I mean, who doesn't want to save money, right? Now, having these autoscalers enabled is cool, but they won't do you any good if you're missing best practices in your deployments, like resource requests. By including resource requests in your deployment manifest, you effectively give Kubernetes information on how much compute it should have available to run a pod. And if you don't have this, workload scheduling will not be as optimal. This is a best practice, and if you were paying attention to the earlier videos, you'll see that deployment safeguards will help remind you of that. But knowing what to set or keeping your resource requests up to date can be hard. This is where AKS Automatic helps you with that by also enabling the VPA, or Vertical Pod Autoscaler. This is also an operator that runs in your cluster and helps you right-size your workloads resource requests based on usage over time. So if you took a guess and requested too much resources in your deployment manifest, then VPA will correct that for use and you won't ever over or under reserve compute in a cluster when it comes to scheduling. Now, all this automation in place is great, but one word of caution here. There will be evictions. As node auto provision and VPA does its thing, it will evict pods and reschedule for optimal performance. And when this happens, you need to ensure that you don't experience any downtime. And to do that, you need to have a PDB, or pod disruption budget, in place. This is another best practice. And this tells Kubernetes the minimum amount of replicas that you need to run. The Kubernetes eviction manager will actually respect the PDB, and you won't be left high and dry when the resizing events happen. It'll always make sure that you have that minimum number of replicas running. Let's see all this in action and see how it all ties together. Here's my resource group, and I have an AKS Automatic cluster. And what we'll do is we'll work from the bottom of the stack and work our way up. What I mean by that is start with the VPA to ensure that we have the right resource requests in place for our workloads. Then make sure our pod replica counts are scaling out with KEDA. And as workload demands are fluctuating, we'll see how AKS Node Auto Provision runs. So the first thing we want to do is go check our cluster and make sure that the VPA is installed. And if I do a kubectl get pods, you can see that I have a bunch of pods here. We have a VPA admission controller, the recommender, and the updater. I won't go deep into all the controller pods here. We'll save that for a future video. This is just to show you that it's all running. Now, I do want to deploy a very simple Nginx pod and work with that in our demo. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and deploy a virtual pod autoscaler. And what this is doing is it basically points at my Nginx deployment, which I don't have yet. I'm going to deploy that in a second. And it's basically telling it the minimum and maximum allowed range. So anything between this range, the VPA will set the resource requests accordingly. So let's go ahead and deploy this. And then let's go ahead and deploy the Nginx pods. And note here that I am running two replicas. VPA won't work if you're running a single replica. It'll actually protect you from that. So I'm setting two replicas just so we can see VPA in action here. So let's go ahead and deploy this. And while that's deploying, let's ensure that our pod does not have any requests set yet. So if I scroll up, you can see here that there's nothing that tells Kubernetes about how much resources I'm going to need for this deployment. Now let's go ahead and watch the pod and see it eventually deploy. So you may have noticed here that the pods were actually in running state and then terminating state. So what I can tell here is that the VPA actually did its job. And if I go check the pods now, I can see here that there are resource requests set on the deployment. So the VPA understood that the CPU should be set to 11 millicores and the memory should be set to about 11 megs. All the VPA did was it edited my pod. It didn't edit my deployment. Now that we know what the request should be, we can actually go ahead and set this on the deployment. So I'll go ahead and copy that and I'll do a kubectl edit and I'll edit my Nginx deployment. Scroll down to the container spec, which is here. And you can see I don't have anything in resources. So I'll go ahead and fill this part in. So we'll go ahead and save that. And we can see here that the deployment has been edited. Now that we have proper requests, Kubernetes will have a better idea on how to schedule workloads onto nodes. Let's try scaling the Nginx deployment using the Azure portal UI, and let's see how this behaves. So what we'll do is we'll head over to workloads and we'll find my Nginx deployment. So where is it? I see Nginx. Where is my Nginx? Let's hit refresh. There we go. And cool part is now the Azure portal also supports creating KEDA scalers using the UI. I'll just go ahead and click create. So we should have a scaler in place. And to verify that, you can head over here to custom resources, scroll down to scaled objects. And you'll see that I have a scaled object in place here. And now our application is ready to scale out based on demand. Let's put some load on this thing. But before we put load on this application, we need to expose it because I just deployed it as a deployment, but I didn't put a service in front of it. So let's go ahead and do that. So I'm on the services and ingress blade here. What I'll do is just click create service and click create. After a minute or so, maybe even less, I should have a public IP. There we go, I have a public IP. Let's go ahead and click it to make sure we can browse to the site. Cool, we're ready to load test. So if I just copy that URL and I head back over into my resource group, I have the Azure load testing service enabled here and I can just configure a quick test. So while that test is running, let's watch the pod. All right, so we can start to see that the number of pod replicas are starting to increase. And note the node names that these pods are being scheduled on. So we can start to see different node names in the list here. And you'll notice that anything associated with this particular node, they're all being terminated. And this new node here, they're all running. So what this tells me is that Karpenter is actually doing its job and auto-scaling our cluster for us. We can go ahead and take a look at that as well. So I'll open a new terminal window here, and I'll run a command to watch the nodes. And here you can see that Karpenter scheduled a standard D2 V3, and we're actually running 86 pods on here. And what I will expect is once the load test completes and KEDA starts to scale down the workload replicas, then this node will also be scaled down to maybe a more cheaper virtual machine SKU. So we'll just keep an eye on this. So the load test is complete, and we're starting to see the pod replica counts coming back down. Eventually, we'll see that the node will be resized and pods rescheduled on a more optimal VM SKU. All right, so we've seemed to normalize now onto this particular SKU, which is a little bit cheaper than the previous one that we were running, so this is good. Now, I know the last thing that you're probably wondering is I had a little bit of a talk around PDBs, but I never showed you how to create a PDB. And what we can do is we can actually use the Azure portal to help us with that. So if I go to my AKS cluster, and if I go to workloads, and if I say create, I will just click this apply a YAML button. Now, you probably don't know how to create a PDB out the gate. We can actually use Copilot to help us with that. And so what I can do is I can just paste in a prompt to say, create a pod disruption budget for my deployment named Nginx and always keep a minimum of 2 replicas. And if I just hit enter, it should draft a manifest for me. I'll go ahead and accept it. And ooh, I see one thing wrong here. It should be policy /V1. So we have a pod disruption budget. That's my name. And this is the label that I want to match on. And I want to ensure that I'm running a minimum available of 2. So go ahead and click add. And there we go. So now if I do a kget PDB, you should see that this is all in place now. So let's close it out with a little bit of a recap. So what we saw here is that AKS Automatic enables all the tools you need to be successful at scaling out your workloads. We have KEDA in place, which is basically a managed add-on in your AKS cluster. And we also have Node Auto Provision, which is able to not only scale out our nodes in the node pool, but also choose and select the right virtual machine SKU that we should be running on. We also saw how VPA, or the Virtual Pod Autoscaler, works to help us with our resource requests in our deployment manifest. And then lastly, we saw how pod disruption budgets can actually help us and protect us when pods are evicted off of nodes for whatever reason, for maintenance or scale up and scale down scenarios. And so again, with AKS Automatic, we have everything we need to scale your workloads. Just remember those resource requests and the PDBs, and you'll be on your way. In the next video, we'll go into application deployment and show how you can go from code to AKS in no time. So be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on the next video. If you haven't checked out any of the previous videos yet, I highly recommend that you go back and check them out. There might be a link to a video here or down here. So yeah, thanks for being here, and we'll see you on the next one. Peace.